Village Board meeting of Monday, November 9th, 2015, to order. Tracy, if you could read the roll, please.
Terry Agia.
Here.
Stephanie Bratton.
Here.
Brett Smolder.
Here.
D'Angelo.
Here.
Mary Pat Lidle.
Here.
Bob Mooney.
Here.
Sarah Utter.
Here.
Before we begin this evening, I would like to remind everyone that this Wednesday, November 11th, is Veterans Day. This is the official day of appreciation for our veterans. Once a year, we honor our veterans. Every day, our veterans honor us with their service. On Veterans Day, please take time to thank those who serve or have served our country's military. We have public appearances. Anyone wish to address the board at this time? Seeing none, we'll move on to public announcements and communications. Public announcements, November 9th through the 13th, Zone 3 brush collection will take place. On November 16th through the 20th, yard waste collection will occur village-wide. November 26th and 27th, that's the Thanksgiving day and the following day, village offices will be closed. December 1st is the first day to circulate nomination papers. And December 1st, winter parking regulations go into effect. Public communications. On Wednesday, November 18th, here in the Municipal Center Community Room from 6:30 to 8:30, the Department of Corrections, along with the McFarland Police Department, will be conducting a sex offender community notification meeting. The purpose of the meeting is to inform citizens of McFarland of the return of a convicted sex offender to the Valley Drive area of McFarland, as well as to answer questions related to community notification practices in general. In the event you're unable to attend the meeting, information regarding this particular offender, along with answers to frequently asked questions, can be found on the police department website. Chief, I don't know if you have anything else that you would like to add to that.
That's pretty much it for now. You mentioned the area of town, I think, where the person will be going, and we'll be doing a targeted notification in that general area as well.
Okay. I've been informed that the Wisconsin Department of Transportation is nearing the end of their comprehensive planning and environment linkage, the PLE study for the Madison Beltline from US 14 in Middleton to County End in Cottage Grove. The study, conducted for nearly 3 years, has evaluated a variety of improvements for all modes of transport, of all modes of travel, and combine them into strategy packages with the potential to address long-term transportation needs for the Beltline. The evaluation results are now being brought forward for public input and feedback at a series of public involvement meetings. Following the public meetings, the selected packages will be further evaluated within an environmental impact statement. The dates of these meetings: Tuesday, November 10th, at 5:30 at Central Hispano, Thursday, November 12th at 5:30 at Cromry Middle School, Monday, November 16th at 11:30 and 5:30 at the Madison Central Library, and Wednesday, November 18th at 5:30 at the Monona Community Center. So if anybody is interested in attending those and finding out what the Beltline future might look like, there's an opportunity to attend and provide your input. I can tell you, if you're not already aware of it, that a Southern Reliever is not one of the options that they're going to be offering. The last thing I have is, a while back at one of our board meetings, We received information from the Department of Administration regarding preliminary estimates of 2015 population. And one of the things that was noticed is as our population increased, the number of tax filers seemed to decrease. And I guess it raised a question in our minds, why might that be the case? Village staff have been trying to get answers to that question. And what they have come up with so far, and it's not a complete answer by any means, here are some of the reasons for that. One, if you're living off of Social Security is not taxed, so you would not be counted as a tax filer. The same would be true as if you were living off of disability, not taxed. Another possibility that had been offered is that individuals have misstated where they live. Instead of recording McFarland as an address, they may have recorded Madison. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me when you look at the discrepancy in regard to the number of people that we are expected to increase and then the significant decrease in tax filers, but that's the information we've received. So anyway, moving on to the consent agenda. We have the special village board minutes of October 22nd, 2015. Are there any corrections to note to those minutes?
Yeah, I have a couple things. On page 7, under budget overview, the last line where it says, and the expenditure restraint will be hit. Can we say that a little differently, like the expenditure restraint limit will be reached? I just didn't like that will be hit. Over on the next page, on page 8, oh, I don't know how, if you go down about, let's see, 11, line 11, where it ends in expenditure, it again says expenditure restraint. I would say would lose the expenditure restraint payment. That's it.
And I have one. It's on page 8. It's in that first paragraph again. It reads, the present budget includes a 1% increase for each employee, and longevity was left within the budget because there was no firm decision made by the board. I thought we had talked about shifting the longevity funds into the merit pay grouping. It was like $17,000.
That may have been the following meeting.
I think it was next time.
Okay. You're right.
I have a couple on page 8. 1, 2. The third line down, it starts on the second line. This will allow funding for non-represented employees to move within, it says the merit pay system. That should say the pay range. Further down, and it's, if you continue on a couple lines later, it says it was noted the current budget was decreased from the published budget. Shouldn't that be increased? I think it was increased from what was published.
I think the published
budget and the budget that we then reviewed was increased from what was published.
I think that's right.
Because the published budget did not necessarily include, for example, a 1% employee pay raise.
Right.
the following budget that we worked on did. So there was an increase, not a decrease. Continuing on, it says there is also an additional $30,000 for grid point adjustments. I think you need to insert, there is also an additional $30,000 for merit pay and grid point adjustments in the budget. A bit further down, it talks about the outreach interim director noted the money is paid for by Dane County. The following line, the proposed finance director position was budgeted for two. I think four should be deleted. About three quarters of the way down on page eight, the increase in legal was based on actual form. I think form should be from. And then following that line, there will be two union contracts to negotiate, and it was suggested to increase, it says legal budget. I think it should be labor legal budget by $2,000. On page nine, the last word, and then technologist position was suggested being added to the budget to fund a full-time position to meet village needs. I think it would read better, a cable department position was suggested to be added to the budget to meet the village's social media and IT needs. And then a little bit following that, the sentence, the funding source in hours for the technologist, I think should also then read similarly, the social media IT position. Those are corrections I would suggest. Are there other corrections to note? Hearing none, then I will move to approve the special village board minutes of October 22, 2015 as amended. I will move to approve prepaid checks 64823 through 64825 in the amount of $511.10 and current checks 64826 through 64926 in the amount of $237,745.05. I will move to approve the recommendation from Police Chief Shervin that the alcohol beverage operator's license applications submitted by Zachary Butson, Loader Oil, Lisa Hegestad, Burns McFarland Tavern, and Sam Timmons, Green Lantern, be approved and the licenses be issued. And I will move to approve the appointment of Shane Stewart to the Communication and Technology Committee for the remainder of the term ending April 30th, 2016.
Second.
Second by Mary Pat. Discussion? Have some questions on the budget. or the budget, on the financial report. And it is, I guess, for me, a clarification. And it starts on page 13 of the financial report, not on the packet number. Goes over to page 14 and then the top of page 15. And it's in regard to check number 64919. These checks seem to be made out to the village of McFarland. Can you help me understand that?
Absolutely. Alan, do you see where it is? It's page 23 of the packet. Okay. The village of McFarland is the payee. That's actually the utilities. So this is our utility bills paid on a bi-monthly basis from the village on behalf of to the utilities itself. So the funds are really coming generally from the general fund that needs to go to utilities. No one's exempt from paying the utility, you know, water, sewer, and storm water. If you look, there are some items that you question, why is there a water bill or a sewer bill? The paths, for example, pedestrian paths on this page 14, about two-thirds of the way down, you'll see lots of numbers for $14.12. Those are the stormwater, the base rate for stormwater for our parcels that we have there as well. So it is something that we've done in the past. It may not have been in the same formats as individually item there, but it would be at least one payee and the full amount to the utilities from the village of McFarland.
So it's what the village owes the utilities in this case?
Correct.
Okay.
Further discussion?
Hearing none, let's vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Moving on to the business portion, discussion and possible action on the 2016 through 2020 capital improvement plan. You want to take out your binders or the updated budget that you had received? Are there any questions, changes to suggest to the 2016 through 20 capital improvement plan?
I'm not asking for any changes. What I'm asking for is maybe some clarification. Under the general administration salaries, some time ago we passed a motion for an additional 20-hour position in the front office area, and up to this point,
we're looking at the capital improvement plan at this
point. Oh, you're working at capital. Sorry.
Yeah. Hold your question because we'll get to that. No changes regarding that? And then I'm going to move on to the next item. Consideration and possible action on potential changes to the following 2016 budget as proposed. Under the general fund, Jerry?
Okay. I'll go back again. And under the general fund salaries, but as I said, some time ago we talked about a 20-hour position that was set up and approved by the board for the front office. Up to this point, I haven't really seen or had any update as to what's happening with that position. So my question then becomes, are we sure that that position is reflected within the budget? Are we sure that that salary is in there?
I think
it's 20 over. It is. Okay. The answer is yes. All right. My other question goes to under the police budget. We're showing an increase there for a investigator position, and I'm aware that we're moving present officer to this position and that we'll be hiring a new officer in that place to replace that person. I'm also aware that our safety committee had a discussion with Shervin, Chief Shervin, about additional sergeant's position. So would you clear, what I would really want to know is clarification for me with just a yes or no answer, if you could, if this salary number includes an additional sergeant's position or not.
I put in an additional about $8,000 for the budget, but there might be room depending on what exactly the increase is.
Number last week, I think it was 8,700 for both.
Yeah.
Does that sound right?
Yeah.
For the sergeant and the investigator. And I think we had originally put 8,000, or you, at some point, 8,000 more had been put in. So that was more than what was needed for the investigator. So I don't know if we originally put both in, or if that's how we came up with 8,000.
I think I had, and this went back many evolutions. Initially, yeah. I had gotten input to put in an increase for an investigator and an increase for a sergeant. And I had put in some lump sum increases, and those amounts got discussed. The number I think I had initially calculated was over $12,000. And then we backed that down to just include the increase for the investigator that was calculated for $8,000. After the budget was approved, Craig and I got together and kind of looked at the numbers that I had used, and in further discussion, we had thought, well, or he had thought that maybe the number I had used just for the investigator increase was a little higher than was required. And so he gave me a lower number for the investigator increase, and then another small number for a sergeant increase. So in reality, if those two numbers were used for the increases for the sergeant and the investigator, there is theoretically enough money in the budget for both of those positions at a lower rate than what I initially calculated, if that makes sense.
And just for clarification, we're not hiring any additional outside staff. I mean, we already did that for the investigator last year, so we're not looking to add another staff person in 16.
Okay. Answer your question. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Any other comments or questions regarding the general fund?
I think this is part of the general
fund. Let me get on the right page here. It's, I lost it. Here, just a minute. It's in the general fund. Anyway, it's for the village facilities rental. And it says over to the side, if I had a page on here, I'd tell you what it was. It says restored revenue expense for youth center, and the figure is 20,000. Am I confused here somewhere?
Yeah, we anticipate 5,000 for other rentals, and so we increase that back up in revenues to the 15,000
so
that
not
we
just
get.
The youth center we're talking
correct.
About.
Okay.
All right.
Other questions? Suggested changes?
I have one more. Southern Village Board, Greg.
Again, I don't have a page. It's under significant budget changes. It says volunteer program coordinator position budgeted at $2,000. It was $1,000 this year. Is that an increase of $2,000? Because we talked about a total of $3,000.
Are you reading from the narrative?
No. Yes, I am. Yep.
Well, then I guess I would say look at the numbers.
Yeah, it's not. I couldn't find it.
There's 3,000 in the
yeah, budget. There's 3,000 in the
okay.
Budget.
Great.
The narrative.
It's 3,000 is what you do for the
stipend for the coordinator.
That's what I would have a question then. I thought the stipend would 25 or the stipend would be $3,000 minus like $300-$400 for materials and supplies.
I had $1,000 for the volunteer program. It was increased to $3,000 through the stipend. So that's what's in here right now is a $2,000 stipend. But the changes, that's.
Yeah, I guess I have a question about that then. You know, I'm not sure how much we would need for materials and supplies for that position. Based on what we used last year, we wouldn't need that much. That's also my impression that we got some type of grant last year, Brad, from the bank, or was it 2 years ago?
The bank has been a sponsor of the Community Service Day. So the money that they donated was specific to expenses incurred for Community Service Day and are not part of the volunteer program as such.
Again, I would propose that for the stipend itself, for this position, be $3,000. A range from at least $2,500 to $3,000. According to what Eric just said, though, we had $1,000 this year. Was that for materials and supplies?
Tom, I think, if I can help try to clarify this.
Yes, please.
The 2015 budget for the volunteer program is at $3,000. Mm-hmm. The administrator's budget reduced that to $1,000.
Correct.
The village board suggested that that be put back increased by $2,000, so the volunteer program would then be as it was in 2015 at $3,000.
Okay.
The how that money gets dispersed is up to the volunteer program at this point.
Okay.
I don't think we, as I understand it, I don't think we put any conditions in regard to so much go for this and so much for that. I think the total package is $3,000 and you make do with that amount.
And that's good clarification. And I certainly can live with that.
The line item itself is the board volunteer program. So any expenses for the program would be under that one line item. It wouldn't impact, in general, other salary lines or anything else. So as Brad said, what it's expended on within that time frame is fine.
Okay, good.
Other questions, comments in regard to the general fund? Hearing none, let's move on to the library fund. Are there any suggested changes, comments regarding the library fund? One question I have, we put into the budget monies for the library fund for an adult services librarian. And I think, Heidi, what you had originally put in was the salary at the minimum of the pay range. And we talked about that typically we have a range from minimum to midpoint. Was there an adjustment made to that potential salary line to cover that difference from minimum to the midpoint?
When I had initially put that position in, I had put it in at $40,000, and then at one of the meetings here, we had discussed increasing that to $46,500. I'm not quite sure where that falls on the grid.
The midpoint.
It does cover the midpoint. Okay, that's my question. So that it is incorporated into the budget or the proposed budget.
Yep.
Okay. Other questions regarding the library fund? Hearing none. Solid waste fund. Any suggested changes there? No? I'm going to, if no one speaks up, I'm just going to move ahead. So if I'm going too fast and you need to catch up, just slow me down and bring me back. Debt service fund. Okay, not hearing any. Capital Projects Fund.
Nope.
engine, the new engine, I could push back to next year, to 17. I just checked, and from one of our vendors, we're looking at a 12-month delivery time. So I don't know if you wait until October of 16 to order it. It may or may not arrive in time for the 17 expenditures, so I don't know how we can deal with that.
If we, assuming we want to go ahead and purchase this engine in 2017, when we order, do we have to put some kind of down payment towards it, or?
It depends on how we write the contract. I mean, there's usually some kind of a down payment, and we can kind of figure that out. But, the big expense typically comes at the end. So, and then we usually typically try to hold some money back, and then that kind of entices them to get things done. And, but it depends on how the contract's written at the time. And, you know, that's dependent on the vendor and market conditions. And so it's just something to be aware of that, you know, if we can't start working on writing specs and get the thing kind of ordered before 17 comes around, we're going to have a period of time there that the truck may not be here that's outside of that year or so.
It wouldn't cost us anything to do the speccing it out.
No, that doesn't cost anything. The vendors are all more than willing to come down on their, you know, just the time that takes our committee to put the spec together. And we can start on it, and then it's just, we, you know, I'm afraid we're going to run into a problem where the truck's not ordered early enough to be delivered in the time period that the budget would, so you'd have to carry the money over or something. It kind of depends on how the borrowing goes, if you're going to borrow for it or how you pay for it.
Okay. Eric, did you?
The item obviously was sort of a Netherland because it wasn't going to fit either the $300,000 levy or the $600,000 short-term borrowing for the capital program. So in terms of ordering it or funding it as we go, as of now, it's in the approved capital funding plan for the five-year plan as a 2017 expense, but the consideration for when to fund it or how to fund it can still be determined. It doesn't need to be determined this evening because we're looking at the 2016 portion of that budget and funding for it. Future debt issuance, either part of our 2016 debt issuance or new debt issuance in 2017 are all feasible. So I just wanted to clarify that for everybody that it's still out there in 2017. We're not necessarily looking at funding it immediately, but the options to fund it are still available as the time comes.
Okay. Any questions, comments in that regard? Okay. Moving on to the Parks Capital Projects Fund. Hearing nothing. The cable website fund.
In your packet, I guess, move to the end. Based on my copying, so I apologize for that. If you're looking in the new packet, it's the last sheets. No offense, Eric. Just a different fell.
Hearing none. TID number 3, and you had some,
yes, I do.
Some corrections to note.
Yeah, I'll pass these out for. I think I have this one. On the sheet itself, I made some corrections after they were copied. This does not impact either the levy or expenditure restraint, first be aware of that. But within the TIF 3, the developer's loan for Wabisa Village as an outlay was added to the line that was for planning engineering services. And so the change is to drop that down to the line below where the comment is and put back in the $10,000 for planning engineering. So overall, that lowers the net revenue over outlay by $10,000 as well. The TIF 3 still cash flows, even if continue to assist TIF 4 with it as well, with their payments. So that's just a typo here that we have identified. So the sheet that went around is the updated version of that.
So just to be clear, what you handed out doesn't change the numbers. It's just a correction.
Correct.
To where that item should be noted in terms of the loan.
Correct.
You gave us those numbers before.
Yeah, I gave the numbers before, but this is the more official budget updated version for your benefit then.
Okay. Any questions on that at all? Comments? Moving to TID number 4 fund. Any suggested changes, comments in that regard? Okay, we will move on to the next item. Discussion and action on the proposed ordinance 2015-08, approving the budgets and the appropriating funds to the general library, solid waste, general debt service, capital projects, parks, capital projects, cable website fund, TID number 3 fund, TID number 4 fund. Funds for the 2016 budget in establishing the 2015 payable and 2016 property tax levy. You have, again, a correction.
Yes, I do. The sheet is a Word document and is not a Excel spreadsheet. So all the numbers given to you, once again, regarding the revenues, expenditure restraint, and so on are correct. There is on the second page, on section 3, a typo that inverted two numbers. Under section 3, the second one down, total all revenues, originally stated $290,080, and it should be $290,800. But the balance required from the tax levy calculation hadn't changed. That's the correct number that should have always been there. So it does not impact, but so you have the corrected ordinance in front of you.
Okay. So having gone through that, are there any questions in regard to what Eric just presented, handed out? If not, then I will move to approve ordinance 2015-08, approving the budgets and appropriating funds to the general library, solid waste, general debt service, capital projects, parks capital project funds, cable website funds, TID number 3 fund, TID number 4 fund, for the 2016 budget in establishing the 2015 payable and 2016 tax levy.
Second.
Second by Mary Pat. Discussion? Hearing none, let's vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries 6-1. Moving on. In the administrator's background materials, it's page 4 of the packet. The personnel committee, in consultation with Kelsey, is recommending that the wording that currently exists in the personnel policy manual be changed. A couple of things that were noted. The previous language basically treated part-time employees all the same in regard to payment of, in lieu of health insurance. So if an employee working part-time worked 17 hours a week or 35 hours a week, they got the same amount. And what this is suggesting is to say that your calculation for payment in lieu will be based on your scheduled and budgeted hours, so that the person who's working 17 hours is not going to get the same amount as somebody who's working 35 hours. And Kelsey, you also, from a practice standpoint, this is a clarification of the language as well, but you ran into or discovered something in terms of how it was being used previously, where the part-time employee was actually getting hit twice instead of just once. I don't know if you want to very briefly describe what happened there.
Sure. The prior calculation basically took that schedule that was in the personnel manual that you guys discussed at the last board meeting, where it kept referring to the 2013 rate premium, the health insurance premium, instead of 2014 or 2015. So they were being calculated on the lowest cost single premium for 2013, so that was the first deduction. Then they were, you'd go to that schedule that was on that page, so if they worked fewer hours, they were being reduced again by the 77.5 or 82% based on where they fell in that column. So that was the second deduction. And then that amount was reduced yet again by the number of budgeted hours. If they were working 20 hours a week, then it was reduced yet another 50%. So it was being reduced three times instead of the simplified language in the agreement. And the language in the prior agreement was very vague as to how it applied to part-time employees for health in lieu. So how this was adjusted is very clear.
So I will move to approve the revised language for payment in lieu of health insurance.
Second.
Discussion?
I'll let you know that if we're going to do this kind of stuff, I prefer that we don't do it without just, what's the right word? Expressing the ordinance number and the everything that we're actually changing, this isn't detailed enough for me. So, you know, I would prefer that we don't do it until we can cite the actual ordinance sections and then have that so that somebody in the future can go back and know exactly what we're doing, what we're changing. We adopted the personnel policy manual. It's got section numbers and subsections and all that stuff. If we're going to take actions to change it, then we should cite those sections. That's all I'm saying. So since that isn't here, I'll vote no.
Do you have the site number offhand?
Yeah. Now, the compensation and benefit manual has in its entirety not been approved yet. So you're approving language that will be fixed into there, which is what we're seeking.
That language, though, is currently part of the personnel policy manual until it's extracted.
Until it's extracted, correct. So currently it's under 12.08 of the new version. I don't have actually the old version about the new version. I apologize.
So I will amend my motion, if you're all right with that, Dan, to cite the provision 12.08, which talks about payment in lieu of health insurance.
I'll accept that.
I think that covers your concern, Claire. Are there other comments? Hearing none, let's vote. All those in favor, say aye.
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 Those opposed? Carry 6-1. Moving on, discussion and possible action to approve directing staff to begin the recruitment process for a public works crew position. And this would be filling due to retirement. I will so move.
Second.
Is that you, Jerry?
Yes.
Discussion? A question that I have in regard, we talk about directing staff to begin the recruitment process. Alan, Eric, Tracy, if we approve this, when is it likely that we would be announcing this position and likely that we'd be hiring? The reason I'm asking this question is we've just approved in the budget a second position. So is this intended to cover both, or just as it's written here, it's just due to the retirement?
I can answer. Because until the board took action just a few minutes ago to approve the budget, that position was not at least funded and still needs to go through a process of position description, unless it's an existing position description that we're following and you're increasing that. The intent is to, we know we have the retirement that needs to be replaced for the position. We know we have a deadline to do that. However, as we get applications, you know, we could potentially, before we do the search, include now a second position with your directive to do so. But the intent at the point in time is we knew there was one retirement that we needed to replace, and that's what we're asking to fill.
You brought up another point, and it was going to be a follow-up question to that. When we say to direct staff to begin the recruitment process, will this board have an opportunity to review the position description that will be offered for both of those positions? I'm not sure if they're going to vary a great deal or vary from what currently exists, but is that anticipated as part of this process?
Anticipation for the new position, yes, is what my anticipated. For the existing position, that's up to you. That wasn't my anticipation because we know we have particular needs.
Just the same crew person.
So
if you wish to have review it, that's no problem.
Is it your feeling, Alan, and you'll need to speak up because sure. I'm having a hard time hearing you. Is it your feeling that the way the duties are divvied up amongst your current employees in anticipation of a new position will basically remain the same? Or will there be some adjustments in regard to what the responsibilities of each position might be?
Right now, the anticipation is to keep it the way
that it is. You know, and the reason for that is we have the person that is retiring. You know, we're going to get in the midst of our very busy season right now from snowplowing that. So I'm not looking to change anything than what we currently have right now.
What is...
Particularly for the new positions, we generally don't fill a new position until the position description has been approved, the wage has been established on, the wage pay range has been established for the position, and the org chart approved for that position, particularly for new ones. And so kind of back up a little bit, so anticipation here is for the existing position, and that we were aware that before we hired the new one, we need to come to you for those approvals.
I guess what I'm trying to suggest is not having to duplicate our efforts and costs by having two separate recruitments. If we can put this all together and look at it and save time and get these people on board, I guess that's kind of the direction I was going.
Pardon me?
delay 2 weeks and bring that next, to the board next time? Is that come?
Yes, we can do that. You know, delay 2 weeks, look at. But
for the one that we currently have right now, I mean, for the second position, for this first position, if you're just doing the math going down through there, if we got approval tonight, you know, and going through the process, I'll have a person that will be retired, and I'll still be trying to get a person just to fill that one, not including this second position. So, you know, my preference would be for this one, knowing that, you know, I wouldn't be making any blanket changes, you know, for that second position. I understand what you're saying, though.
You know, the other concern I have is, depending on when this process starts, you're going to be running into December holidays, which is not a great time to be recruiting and hiring individuals. They typically, my experience has been, that's not a time that people are really tracking in terms of job opportunities. Other things kind of get in the way. I don't know how this is going to play out. I understand your concerns and your needs and so forth. I guess I'm searching for answers here. And again, I'd rather not try to duplicate our efforts if we can possibly avoid that.
Absolutely. And I'm in agreement with that too. You know, and what I want to, what I'd like to do is send out, at least start advertising, see what we get back in, you know, to fill the position. You know, I'm very hopeful, you know, and optimistic that we can get people that can fill the position that we currently, you know, have that's open. You know, we do not have big changes in place, you know, for looking at shuffling things up in the department, you know, similar to, you know, and my hopes also, as Eric had suggested, is that, you know, we get this pool that comes in, you know, if you approve the second position, even if that's in a month from now, that's fine. You know, it's just, you know, I want now to, I'd like to go now to hopefully get approval on this so we could fill that position, because when the snow starts flying and the water mains start breaking, you know, that's when you scramble looking for personnel.
I think what I hear Alan saying is the position that's retiring, the individual that's retiring, he needs that filled as quickly as possible so there isn't a gap there.
Exactly.
Because of the weather and whatever. I know your concerns about not doubling efforts, but I think I also hear you saying if you get that advertisement out there, you'll have a pool of candidates, hopefully. And the second one, once we get it all in place, can probably
come from
that pool. So I don't see us really doing a lot of duplication.
And that's my hope. And I,
okay.
Yes, that's
how
our
I'm
hope too.
I'm understanding it as well. So, and as far as from a salary standpoint, I would think they're both going to be basically the same, right?
Absolutely.
And the organization structure is going to be the same.
Absolutely.
And your job descriptions are probably going to be the same.
Absolutely.
And if that's the case, it seems, as you said, Brad, why are we not rolling these together?
Because.
And advertising for two.
Well, because you can't really say that yet. I mean, right? I mean, we know we have one. But you're going to gather that pool, and as soon as we get another position description and whatever, we can go for the second one.
Well, and I think in stepping back here a little bit, as Eric, you know, when we talked prior to this, until you approve the budget tonight, that position wasn't approved, that other one.
That's right.
You know, so that's why we didn't want to include this for both positions in case that, you know, that came forward, you know, and we didn't want to delay the one that we currently had right now.
Okay, so I think we're, as I'm hearing it, we're all basically saying the same thing.
Yep.
So
I just want to say that your comments, Brad, are interesting to me, because the methodology we used to fail to hire a senior outreach service director should be part of what we're talking about here. And I'd like to get the process going, but the village board last year's priority, one of them, was to do the organizational study, which we didn't really do other than to look at the senior outreach services. But I still think that's an important thing to do. As the public works chair, we didn't actually sit with Alan and talk about those parts of this position that is related to Public Works. Mary Pat and the Public Utilities Committee never sat and talked about the percentage of this position. So theoretically, we could just hire from the same pool and everything would stay the same. But at the other side, maybe we should be doing the organizational look at the Public Works Department and the staffings. And so if we end up doing that process that we were going to do, and hopefully we'll continue to go forward, we maybe won't hire this person until February, March, April, or May, or maybe even June, so we can get that work done. And that, you know, and I think it's work that I would like to see done. So for that reason, I just want us to hire right away, get the ad out there. But I don't want us to skip over what I think is our responsibility to look into the new position we've agreed to pay for, and then organizationally whether we could make improvements or savings or whatever. It's possible, maybe not, but that's my opinion. So, and I think the board previously wanted to do that, and I think we should continue. I don't want to, we should advertise tomorrow, get a pool, yes, but going forward, I don't want to hire the person starting January 1 for the new position until we vet it, at least Public Works and Public Utilities Committees, and maybe the Parks Committee in terms of this job. So that's just, so I support a motion to hire if we need one. I move to create this pool as item.
We already have a motion to that effect.
Call for the question.
In a second.
No.
Other comments?
Tracy, is it, if we posted a second position at a later date, and that position was based on a position description that didn't read exactly like the one we already posted, can we use that candidate pool off that list for that new posting?
As long as there's nothing significant that changes, right. Then okay. That should be okay.
All right.
Any other comments? Questions? Hearing none, we have a motion and a second to direct staff to begin the recruitment process for the Public Works crew positions. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Discussion and possible action to approve directing staff to begin the recruitment process for a clerk assistant 3 position. Again, filling a position due to retirement. I will so move.
Second.
Comments, Eric? This is for Diane's position?
Correct.
Okay. And again, her retirement date is?
End of January.
Have you considered any changes from an organizational standpoint in answering Claire's, or at least going along with Claire's comments? Have you looked at the organization? Do you see any changes that are necessary, particularly with a question that Jerry asked? You have that position, you have a half-time finance specialist / administrative assistant position. We have a billing clerk position in Public Works. Have you looked at how all those pieces come together and if there are any changes anticipated in regards to the organization structure?
I think there's opportunities that can be looked at to present that. But the duties themselves are not likely to change. The roles that we have, the tasks and duties that need to be filled are likely to be the same. I think it would be based on the candidates hired for this position and for a part-time person, potentially then to offer some changes once we get some candidates pool in here. But the tasks themselves are set. It's a matter perhaps of looking at the staffing. We did with the do a recruitment for the part-time administrative position as well as the utility clerk position, looked at blending those and making a potentially recommendation if we have some candidates that were interested in combining that. But the ones that we had seen and the best, I think, fit for your position there was specifically looking for part-time hours, not interested in looking at additional hours for the tasks. So I think there's opportunities to look at that overall, but to get the tasks themselves complete, I think beginning a recruitment process to see what we end up with may make some sense that way, knowing we still have another position available that we need to fill. So I think the position descriptions themselves would likely stay the same, perhaps reporting relationships or the division of tasks amongst the people that are in place may be coming to you in the future. That's how I would anticipate that. In terms of actually saving and not necessarily hiring the candidates there, I would suggest continue to move forward to get the bodies in place. Like I said, I do see potentially some division of tasks when we get some candidates in there that may adjust depending on backgrounds, particularly because the part-time position we're looking for and approved has the finance side. And if we get a candidate for this position that's stronger in the finance and some background in the admin as well, there may be ways to balance those two positions, that the 1.5 positions that we have available. So yes, I have looked at it, but
what I heard you say, and maybe I misunderstood, but in some ways you're going to form your organization based on the people who apply for this position?
In some ways, but and mostly it's we're looking at the tasks that need to be accomplished and how do I accomplish those tasks that need to be there. As we discovered when Diane was out, sort of the ability to really divide those tasks was limited. And so it's really looking at, we know we have a position, I think we need to fill those position and those duties of the position description. But if we get a candidate that perhaps has stronger finance background, then there may be time to look at adjusting based on that. So in short, too late, I know. Yes, I'm filling the position as is, but as a candidate comes in, there may be opportunities that we can bring forth.
See, to me, that's sort of backwards. You know, to me, we take a look at the vision of all staffing here in the village, and then we hire for that revised position. Because otherwise, it really becomes dependent on the different individuals that are in those roles.
But sometimes that's what happens.
I mean, theoretically, I don't disagree with you, but I see Eric's point that if you get somebody that you see fits into another position that you're looking for, that certainly is not beyond my understanding of a correct way that you can go. We've already looked at what we need and come up with the positions that are out there now. Quit shaking your head. I mean, it's just practicality. It's the way it shakes out. And sometimes that's the way we have to operate.
But the flip side would be, if you have a position posted with all these different tasks, you might have a different pool of candidates to select from. You know, we don't know what strengths or skills some of the candidates come with, except what's already listed on that job description. Yeah. I like to say it more broad.
We should maybe touch base a little bit. We have a clerk, clerk one, clerk two, and clerk three, I believe, in the village. And they normally, it's kind of like, I think clerk one is entry and clerk two is the next step, and then clerk three is the highest step. So maybe we don't need a clerk three full-time. Maybe we need a clerk two full-time and a clerk three half-time or part-time. So I'm trying to go along with what you're saying, Tom, and that's why I said, Brad, back to what the board wanted to do, the organizational reworkings. You know, the current clerk three that's retiring got to be a clerk three because of all her years of service and the additional things that she took on, but she wasn't originally. And the discussion, Mary Pat, didn't take place to get that happen. It took place because of what she was doing. So, all again, I don't want us to be left shorthanded. And I don't know that it's a good idea to try and get a part-time person. So I don't know how to get the questions answered that I'm raising. You had talked to
just one
staff. But
clerk three isn't specifically just because you've been in position. It's you expect for the level of independence of
That's what I'm
right. So It's not just because they've been here and they worked their way up. It's what we expect of that position to do. Be relatively independent, have some money control. You know, we're a clerk one, we wouldn't really look at that. So that aspect there. And then the other side is I think there's opportunities, like I said, to look at based on the candidates. But my goal is, we know there's a deadline and we need to fill it. And I think there's been some concern about not moving to fill positions. And so my intent here is to ask for permission to fill the position. We know we have roles and we know we have duties, and there may be some opportunities that present themselves, but my goal is to fill the position that we know is critical. So it's a better way of answering.
I agree with that. We need to fill it, man. And that's why I just want, the worst in case is we put out with what we have for description, the clerk three description, and recruitment purposes, and that will be the highest level. So if we was to have discussions about a little different approach, we wouldn't necessarily be limiting ourselves. We would have the very best pool, even if we decided to talk about and change it a little, part-time, whatever. It's all. So, and I do want us to hire somebody.
Yeah, I think it's.
Otherwise, we have a motion and a second to approve having staff start the recruitment process for the clerk three position. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries 7-0. Discussion and possible action requesting the creation of a 2016 police department hiring list to direct the police chief to seek approval from the police and fire commission of the process. I guess I'm not quite sure what this is. Is this basically, let me ask the first question, is there any cost associated with this?
Well, I mean, with the process itself, or you mean budgetary impact in terms of hiring the person?
No, the process itself. Is that why we're asking the board to approve this, because there's a cost associated with it, or is it simply a matter of saying we want to go out and create a list?
We want to go out and essentially we are creating a list to cover any potential vacancies that may come to light next year. And that's about all I can say about that right now. The cost is probably about $100, which we take out of the hiring budget, correct, Eric? There were a few questions from board members why this is coming forward, I guess. And in past years, there's been discussion back and forth whether positions that are already approved need to come before the board, and it's been kind of a mixed bag. So that's why we're here tonight. I'm not looking to add a new position, simply to get a jump on putting together a list to hire vacancies that might occur in 2016.
Can I ask how you do it now? I mean, when you have a vacancy, then you go out and look for a list? I mean, you go out.
Well, the first thing we do is look at our existing list, if we have an opening, and see if there's anybody that we can hire off our existing eligibility list. We usually keep those about a year. There is not in this case, so we want to establish a new one.
So are you saying that in the past you have had a list like this and right now you don't? Is that what I'm hearing?
We have nobody left on our current list who would be viable for a position.
But you have done this in the past, mm-hmm. and had a list. You mm-hmm. just want to get another list.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Craig, when you have created a list in the past, and when it comes to a vacancy, and you go back to that list, how many of those potential on the list are no longer available? Because they've...
The Police and Fire Commission generally gives us 10 to work with. In recent years, 4 or 5 probably I would consider hiring of those 10. And well, for instance, our current list is less than a year old, and there is nobody in the top 5 any longer that hasn't been hired someplace else. And there's nobody left on the list that I'd be comfortable moving forward with at this time.
So knowing that there's such a gap, you know, between creating the list mm-hmm. and posting for a vacant position, you know, that's months of time usually. A lot of changes can occur. I'm just wondering if it's a good use of your time to create a list.
I think it is, and I wish I could share more. Mm-hmm. I just, at the moment, that's about all I can share.
Okay.
for reasons that I'd be happy to discuss outside of the meeting.
If we'd approve this, when would you anticipate a list being created?
Well, one reason I brought it to you tonight is because the Police and Fire Commission is meeting Saturday, so it's very timely. If I get your approval tonight, then I can get, they have to actually approve the timeline, the actual process itself. And then we would start on this right away. We'd probably take applications into mid-January just because of the holidays. Normally, we wouldn't probably take them quite that long, but extending that a little bit because of the holidays. And then we'd start interviewing right away. There's, this is a little probably different than the way I've done this in the past. And again, there's valid reason for it. I just can't discuss it here in the meeting.
Well, with the extenuating circumstances as they are, I guess I would move that we approve the action requesting the creation of a 2016 police department hiring list and to direct the police chief to seek approval for the from the Police and Fire Commission for the process.
I'll second.
I got Stephanie first, so.
Further discussion?
If we go ahead and do this, could I request that Chief you come back a year from now?
Just give us a status report on how well it worked this coming year. Because I'd just be curious.
Good. Okay. Any other comments?
Just expect that you'll be back before a year with hiring. It's going to be possibly taking place, and hoping he still has a list left.
I hope so too.
But this isn't changing anything. No. You know, if we need a few officers, if we go get somebody leave, whatever, he'll be back. So.
Well, I think it's always good practice to be proactive.
Yeah. So.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. To have the police chief talk to the Police and Fire Commission about establishing a list for hire. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, the motion carries 7-0. Discussion and possible action regarding resolution 20-2015, withdrawal from the local government property insurance fund effective December 31st, 2015, and to approve coverage by the municipal property insurance company in the amount effective January 1, 2016, in the amount effective, is there an amount to be effective in 2016 that we did not, it's in the background information?
Page 35.
It'd be $11,207.
Is every July. There was talk this year of dissolving the property fund by the legislators, but that did not happen. However, for next year, they're speculating that the increases will be a minimum of 100%, and they're not so sure they can pay all the claims. And so the league, who has our other insurances, offered this insurance, and this was the third. I received three quotes. And this was the lowest of the three quotes for the exact same product that we currently receive with the same deductibles. And this will run on a budget year versus half a year where we have half the quote and then we have to go get the other quote. So it's better fiscally to do it this way. And it was a slight increase of, right now, our renewal for 2015 to 2016 was just over $10,000, so it's about a $1,000 increase. But it was the cheapest out of the three quotes, so.
This program is something that has been worked through the League of Municipalities?
Correct,
yep. And,
the
when you say three quotes, are there three different insurance companies?
There was a private one, the previous insurance company we had, and then the league won't, or not the league, the local government property insurance fund said theirs would increase a minimum of 100% for next year, which we only have half a year. So not a lot of places cover property in the open a lot of your larger buildings like we have. So that's the challenge too, is finding a provider that actually covers municipal type items, especially the property in the open, like the water towers, stuff in the parks, that kind of stuff.
If the new insurance would start January 1st of 2016,
mm-hmm.
are we double insuring for half a year?
Nope. We will get a refund check for about half a year. They'll refund us that amount back.
Okay, so if we drop their program, we get that half year back.
Correct, yep. We did that with the auto for 2015. They refunded us a portion because, like I said, we renewed in July, so we got a prorated portion back.
Did I understand you to say that this company is a subsidiary group or a sponsor group through the league?
Correct, yep.
Is there a track record here? Have they been in existence long?
They scrambled to put together a program anticipating the league or the local government property insurance fund dissolving. So this is, they're basically just getting into it because they thought the pool was dissolving. When they passed the budget, they didn't dissolve it. However, a lot of communities are going essentially to this municipal property insurance company anticipating that their premiums are gonna increase a minimum of 100% for next year.
It makes sense as long as you believe in the viability of the insurer.
Mm-hmm.
And without a history, that's a little difficult to.
Yep.
It's a situation that your municipalities are between a rock and a hard place, because the state program, as Tracy had indicated, had been discussed to be dissolved. And so the league, as she said, kind of looked and searched for companies that could provide such insurance. Because the state had a program, those insurance companies didn't exist. So what we're doing is, you know, basically rolling the dice with a company. I know the league has sponsored this, as she said. I know, and I've talked to other municipalities, and they're on board with this as well. They think it's a good program, but it's one of those things that time will tell. But I don't know what other choice we really have.
That's what I was going to say. The alternative isn't acceptable.
Yeah.
So I guess we're going to have to go there.
I can speak that some of the claims right now that are current are not currently being paid through LGIPF right now. It's not been my experience with them in the past. So that's the additional concern I would have. While there's risk going to potentially a new company, even though we don't know what happened in June, we have a current plan, there's quite frankly a risk to staying where we are as well.
And just to refresh everybody's memory, the state actually put themselves into this position by taking whatever they thought was excess money in this insurance program and giving it back, only to find that they ended up short when claims started coming through. So as an alternative, rather than continuing to raise premiums beyond what municipalities could cover, the solution was to dissolve the program. So anyway, with that said, I will move to approve resolution 20-2015, which withdraws from the Local Government Property Insurance Fund effective December 31st, 2015, and approve coverage by the Municipal Property Insurance Company in the amount of $11,207 effective January 1, 2016.
Second.
Second by Mary Pat. Further discussion?
Just want to ask, are we for sure doing this? Because having watched this process, and watch the gentleman from the league come and make the presentation, and having the decision made to do it already once, I just want to make sure that this time we're actually going to do it. This is it, right? We're actually doing this?
The gentleman that came and gave the presentation, we did switch that in 2015. That's for our general liabilities insurance, and that was switched over.
Okay.
This is now for our property insurance.
Okay. I'm cleared up.
Yep.
Thank you.
Other questions, comments? Hearing none, let's vote. So all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries 7-0. Authority, Board, Commission, and Committee Agenda Item Requests, Referrals, and Updates. Hearing none, we are at adjournment. Objections? Hearing none, by unanimous consent, we are adjourned. Thanks, everybody.